Good evening, everyone. I'm Veda, and I come from Bangalore, and I have my two co-authors from the same institute. And this work was carried out under the INTMAS program funded by Government of India under the MEMS community chip. So the contents are start from the system level diagram, take you to a little into the brief history of why we, how this all began, and how we have moved towards the directional microphone, a mechanical model, the simulations I carried out, and fabrication at MEMS cap foundry. Characterization and packaging was, and the ROIC integration was done at Sense IIC, and I'm grateful to many of Rudra Pratap sir's students and MM Naik sir's students for that. So this is a system level block diagram. So how does a microphone work? Yes, it takes first the signal, acoustic signal, and that is transferred to a CMOS interface circuitry, and finally we give to the speaker and see if we get back the same result. I mean, to the literature survey. So why it's for me important to tell about literature is that many years back, when directionality became an issue to sense acoustic signal, they began work in it, and the first microphone that they actually started working on was called as the shotgun microphone, which you can see here. And the polar plot of that shows that it has directionality at the front as well as at the back. So this has a disadvantage that it could get signals from both sides, and you didn't know whether the front, the sources, or at the back. The side lobes were less significant. So it moved a little further, the research, and they overcame a problem, this problem, by having an array of microphones where they have the person in the middle, the person who needs to sense, or the microphone in the middle, and you have an array on all the sides. And depending on time difference of arrival of sound, they detected using an algorithm the directionality. So you can see the polar plot. It shows that from the array, it could make out, yes, the source is on one side. But the problem here is that the whole system becomes bulkier because you have more number of microphones. It's not one single microphone which can detect the directionality. So finally, where do we go when we don't have a solution? Is we look at nature, and that's what happens. So they looked at nature for a solution where we could find a single solution, a single microphone that can replace multiple microphones and get the same result. So there are few biological creatures which have this directionality built in them. To start with, a snake. So how does a snake work? It doesn't have a hearing organ. Most of us know it. And it is able to sense the directionality, or it is able to sense the acoustic signal, because when it crawls on the ground, it has a jawbone which vibrates when we start moving on the same floor as it, same ground level. So even at a distance of 500 meters to 1 kilometers, it can sense this vibration through its jawbone, which is in turn connected to its brain, and move away from the path. So it doesn't really have a hearing organ, but it still works. Next, coming to the ladybird, if you see the antenna there, the antenna is so wonderfully designed that when a predator comes to attack it, say a bird wants to attack it, and when the bird is coming near it and the wings are flapping, the wings flap at a certain frequency, and this antenna is able to detect exactly that frequency. So when it detects that frequency, it moves away from there. So that's how even the ladybird protects itself. So it has a directionality, it has a sensing organ. Now, coming to cricket, I don't know how many of you saw this live demo of Professor Rudra Pratap that just went out in front of our session here. He worked on developing the speaker using the cricket insect, and my work is exactly opposite. I have worked on a fly that eats the cricket insect. So the cricket insect also has a very wonderful way of detecting acoustic signal. If you see here, this is the small hearing organ in the cricket. It has, if you'll see the blown up version, the acoustic signal enters from this cavity and it moves all the way to this and enters the tympanum, which is actually like our hearing eardrum membrane. So it has a time difference of arrival of sound. So if you can mimic this mechanically using a mechanical model, as is shown by an author here. He has replicated it. So what he has done is he's taken a cantilever, deposited a piezoresistive film. Now, if acoustic source is on this side, through this cavity, the signal goes and it hits at the bottom and it vibrates. So then a signal that would come, if it was here, it would vibrate much faster. So a signal source which is here will take much longer to travel through this cavity, which is mimicked exactly in the same way as compared to a signal source that would be right here. So we're trying to create this length exactly equivalent to that in the cricket flying hearing organ. So this was also done. So when we look at a microphone, the two important parameters that a person needs to work, a researcher needs to work, is one is on the sensitivity aspect of it, and the other one is on the directionality. And this is exactly what I have tried to do. And I worked on the directional microphone, which is inspired by a fly called the Ormia Ochracea. It's a parasitoid which eats up the cricket by laying its larva on the cricket insect. So these are some pictures of it. So I have a blown up version of the fly. So if you look, that is exactly where the hearing organ of this Ormia fly is. So if you want to really understand how small this fly is, if you have your thumb, how small our home fly are, exactly that miniaturized version is. It can sit on our thumbnail. It's that small. And its hearing organ is only this much. It sits exactly there in this part. So it's very, very small. Now, how do we human understand directionality is, when someone speaks to me on my right, my right ear hears the signal first than my left. So that sends a signal to the brain, and that's how I differentiate. It's called time difference of arrival. But when we look at a very small organism like this, where the hearing organs are very close to each other, this time difference of arrival will not work. So there's a different mechanism by which it has to sense this directionality. So this is the SEM image of the hearing. So this is where the organ sits. So SEM image only of the hearing organ is this. So it has two membranes, ipsilateral and contralateral. And there is a pivot which connects both the membranes, right? So ipsilateral is, if you are taking the acoustic signal on this side, the membrane that is close to the acoustics source is called as the ipsilateral, and the far away one is the contralateral. But here, as I said, time difference of arrival will not work because they're extremely close. How does it work? So to understand that, we have built the mechanical model. So these are the pivots, these two, and these two are the membranes, and I have the comb drive structure. So I do the capacitive sensing. And now what happens is, if I have the acoustic signal on this side, on the right hand side, this membrane will go down and this membrane comes up. So there is a change in capacitance that happens on either side. And from this change in capacitance, I am going to detect the directionality. So this is exactly how we structured it. That was a COMSOL result. And this is one thing that I want to tell about the fly, is how it detects the cricket insect. So even in darkness, it is able to sense exactly where the cricket is, because cricket, when it calls its mate, it makes a certain sound, and a certain breed of cricket makes the sound at 8 kilohertz. So this particular fly can detect, its hearing organ actually resonates only at 8 kilohertz, whereby it goes in that direction, hits the cricket insect, lays its larva on that, and after 5 to 6 days, the cricket insect perishes. So it doesn't even get to know that something has laid its larva. So what I try to mimic is exactly that at around 8 kilohertz, around that, this structure should resonate. So I have made this structure, and I have improved the sensitivity by introducing springs, by making it a little more flexible, and various other structural changes. I have been able to make it resonate exactly at 8 kilohertz, as you can see in the simulation result. And the two modes of vibration, the rocking mode and the bending modes, are seen. So this shows that when the acoustic signal is on one side, either side, it moves up and down. So to know at exactly where we'll get the best sensitivity, we try to change the comb drive, the teeth length. So we started with 80 micrometer overlap area and we found a particular sensitivity. Then we moved to 90 micrometer, then 190 up to 200. But what we found was when we were at 190 micrometer, the capacitance we got was 0.4 picofarad. But when we moved to 200, it dipped to 0.2. So this is, but till 190 micrometer square, it was increasing, the sensitivity was increasing. It's only after that we found that there was a dip. So this can be attributed to the fact that as the cantilever's length increases, its flexibility will also increase. So what happens is beyond a certain point, if you apply the pressure, it dips much more. So because of that, the sensitivity also will decrease. And this, we have plotted this with the simulation results we plotted, and we got that yes, at 190 meter micrometer square, I get the best sensitivity. And so I froze my design at that point and I didn't take it further. So the design was ready and we fabricated it using SOIMUMPs process at MEMSCAP Foundry, thanks to the NPMAS funding group. And the substrate is silicon and the device layer also is silicon, on which we have deposited pad metal, which is gold, and completed the device. And this is the fabricated device image, which you can see. And there are various dimension details of the device. And between each comb drive, we had a gap of 10 micrometers. So the MEMSCAP Foundry gives it at 5 micrometer, but we kept it at 10 just to see that, you know, it doesn't stick to each other and we get a release structure. So we kept it at 10, but probably the sensitivity can improve if you decrease this. And you can see the overlap area is 190 micrometer and so on. And we have springs attached, which increase the flexibility and the sensitivity improved. Post that, we did some wafer level characterization, and these are the setups at IIC Sense, and we got the CV. The base capacitance without applying any pressure was found to be about 1.5 picofarad, and you can see now the simulation results are matching with my fabricated results at 8 kilohertz. So this shows that the simulation, the characterization, and the required parameter of replicating the hearing organ of the fly actually is the outcome. We were able to replicate it. And some of the vibrometer results, the bending mode and the rocking mode of the fabricated devices are here. And what I did further was I did a prototype packaging. So I took an FRC PCB and I induced or dug out two holes which were 100 micrometer apart, because the distance between the two membranes are 100 micrometer. So exactly, and it is of the dimension of the membrane, the hole diameter. Exactly on these holes, I placed the device such that the membrane is able to get the acoustic pressure. Then what I did was I closed one of the holes and applied pressure only on the other. So there is a blocked wing and there is an open wing. So if you can see the results here, when I have blocked it on that wing, the variation capacitance is very low, which is what should happen because it's not getting directly the acoustic signal. Whereas the wing that is open, the capacitance drastically varies. This is what should happen, because which side of the membrane gets the acoustic signal, the variation should be extreme. So that shows that it is able to sense the direction of the acoustic source. These are all near field characterizations. So I had the acoustic calibrator, which is shown here. So exactly on top of the acoustic calibrator, I have put my device. And I found the resonant frequency now post packaging also to be at around 8 kilohertz, which matches all my results. Then I went for far field characterization. Now, when I have to do the far field characterization, I needed a mouth simulator, because we all speak at around 2 kilohertz, 3 kilohertz. Maxima might be 5 kilohertz, but not beyond that. So, and I needed it to be placed about a distance where we humans will talk on a microphone. So, I won't really put this inside my mouth and speak, right? I have it a little far. So, all microphones should be tested at far field, not at near field. So, Professor Rudraprasad's students and his lab gave me all the setup. And we did this using the mouth simulator and the lock-in amplifier and mounted the device on an incliner. So this was my setup. So I have the mouth simulator and this is the incliner on which my device is located. And I tilted these devices at different angles and I tested for its directionality. And I've got pretty good results. And the same setup I took to the mechanical department of Indian Institute of Science, where they have the anechoic chamber, and arranged the same setup there. So you can see the incliner better here. And on bottom of this is my device, which is mounted. And this is the mouth simulator. And I have the preamplifier and the lock-in amplifier. And I take the reading. Now, the lock-in amplifier gives me readings in terms of current. Okay. So this is the result that I got, that in variation in terms of degree and the current that I've got. This I converted to capacitance using basic Ohm's law. And I got the variation in capacitance versus the degree. And finally, I integrated it with ASIC, which is MS3110, and I got the voltage sensitivity to be about 0.01 millivolt per Pascal. So the earlier literature said about 0.1 femtofarad was the sensitivity, and mine is 0.7 picofarad. So that's a lot of improvement in the device design. So these are my references, and I would like to acknowledge IEEE, which funded my registration charges, MP Mass for fabrication and characterization, and SENSE for all the help in every activity of my life. Thank you.